Good afternoon. Thank you very much for coming. I'm also really thankful for having these incredible architects and engineers here this afternoon. And the idea of these sessions is just to listen to them, their brilliant practices in their own words, and I would say that's the key thing, to explain what they brought here to the Biennale, what is the knowledge or the projects that they wanted to share with all of us, and in their own words, to explain why should we care about what they're doing, what were the difficulties, or to give us some insights of what it took to either build what you've seen there, or the projects, if the project is not here somewhere else, what is the difficulty, what is the frictions that they have to overcome to get things done. And that will be pretty much the same, the first part of the conversation. It is mainly a conversation, it is not a lecture. We were talking to try to share in the most honest possible way things that you can't find in the internet. Things that only because you are here and they're here will appear in this moment. So in case you don't know them, over there we have Simon Vélez from Colombia working in bamboo. His exhibition is in the Central Pavilion. Over here it's Philippe Bloch from Oxendorf Bloch and De Jong, the structure you've seen here beyond Bending and the Corderier here in the center and the main building here. Gloria Cabral and Solano Benitez from Paraguay, winners of the Golden Lion. And Werner Sobeck from Germany, also with the cube installation here from the lightweight structures department from Stuttgart. If there is a common thread here today, is forces, it's weight, it's structures. I mean, and all these people have been spending a lot of time and knowledge and understanding the forces at play from different backgrounds, from different approaches. So I will start by that and maybe with Werner, that is right here, so that you can share with us what should we be looking at in what you presented here. And I know you're very interested in air, for example, and using air as structure, but it's up to you. Please share with us. Yes.
Thank you. When Alejandro called me up and invited me to do a presentation here to install something, it was quite obviously after a few days of thinking about it that we are not going to present a project or some very concrete and detailed thing, but that we try to somehow symbolize the background of all of our work, the condensation of all of our thoughts. So what you see here, some of you might have seen that, is a cube, a white cube, the length of which is 4 meters 66.0927xxx, which is the so-called Feigenbaum constant. And Feigenbaum constant is one constant within a complicated mathematical formula which describes the growth of any population. Mathematicians consider the Feigenbaum constant to be as important as p or pi. And this value, 4.6609, exactly describes the transition from a normal, regular growth into chaos. And in my opinion, this is actually the point where we are standing in front of. Second thing, this is a white cube, and there's something in it, and there's no door. This traces back to old Egypt. 3000 before Christ, in the old Egypt temples, they had a room which was called the Abaton. This was the most holy room, but there was no door into that room. And the Abaton enclosed the truth. And the idea of those Egyptian priests was to make it very clear that no one of us will ever experience or comprehend the truth. So we took this idea of an abaton, of an enclosed space, with the length of the Feigenbaum constant. We wrapped it with textile in a total recyclable way so that the pavilion might disappear without leaving any waste, and we printed the final protocol of the intergovernmental group of climate change onto it in 12 languages. And we cut it, those protocols in 12 languages in single sentences, and we mixed them up, and we printed it on the surface, and we threw a black piece of fabric over it in order to make clear that even if you try to understand the complexity, and most human beings don't even try, even if you try to understand the complexity, you are completely lost. You will never experience the entity because it's on the one hand side too complicated, it is too complex, and the data you are basing your ideas and your thoughts on are in many cases manipulated. So you are somehow lost in a certain darkness. End of the story number one. Story number two, we asked ourselves the question, how many people are living on that earth? Okay, everyone knows, at least some of you know, it is 7.4 billion. A number so high that you really cannot really imagine it. And most of us did not experience this explosion of the population. And then I asked the question, how many kids are within those 7.4? And this is a number nobody really knows. It is 1.8 to 2 billion kids, means people being younger than 16, living still at home and get it feeded by the family. But this means within the next 16 years, 2 billion people will leave home. The beds won't get empty because of new kids to be born, and ask for a habitation, for a working place, and for an infrastructure. This is a net amount of growth. And I said, okay, what does this really mean, 2 billion people in 16 years? And we went back on the time scale, and we realized, okay, this was the world of 1930. Means we have to add to the already built world the entire world of 1930 once more within 16 years. Or in other words, we have to build London and New York and Santiago de Chile and the Trans-Siberian Railway and everything within 16 years. Then I said, okay, what does this mean resource-wise? And again, a question nobody could answer, interestingly. What does it mean resource-wise? And we did some research and we found out that every German citizen owns 490 metric tons of building material. Because every German citizen, also Italians and Swiss ones, etc., owns a certain area of autobahn, highway, typically more than his own habitation. He owns a part of civic hall and a sewage plant and a bridge and whatever and whatever. In total, 490 tons. 490 tons, 490. And if you say, okay, if we build for all these newcomers on this globe a German standard, then we have to build 2 billion divided by 16 years, which is 125 million per year added, multiplied by 490 metric tons, is a sum of 60 billion tons per year to be produced and to be installed to make buildings and roads and whatever out of it. Now, what does it mean, 60 billion tons? I could not imagine what that means. So I finally said, let's do the following experiment and let's build a concrete wall along the equator once around the world every year. 40,000 kilometers long, and the typical thickness of a concrete wall, which is 30 centimeters. How high is the wall which we have to build every year? Indicating the amount of material we have to produce, and probably also giving an indication about the amount of waste we are producing. Now, if you evaluate that, The result is 2,000 meters every year for the next minimum 20, 25 years. Then we started researching, is the material available? Is there really 15 billion tons of sand available every year? And it is not. Is the wood available? It is not. Are the additives available to make steel out of iron? It is probably not. And then we became very radical and we say, okay, let's forget about all that efficiency talks, energy efficiency and so on, because we do not have an energy problem. This is just misleading the people. There's enough solar energy there. We just made the mistake to use fossil-based energy for 100 years and to cause global warming. But if we overcome fossil-based energy, you can just waste energy. The sun is radiating 10,000 times more energy onto the globe than all human beings needs for all their activities. Factor 10,000 times. So this is not the point. And then we can condensate, and this is my end now for my statement, all what is necessary into two statements. Statement number one, build more for all these kids with less material, of course, in a fully recyclable way. And the second thing is, do not use any fossil-based energy. And with those two headlines, these are the headlines of all of our work.
So your research in how to make structures that use less material and the role of air in that is, can you give a little bit of that background?
Yeah. Okay. Now I'm a typical German, let's say, half-time practitioner and half-time professor. So I'm running a research institute at University of Stuttgart with a big group of researchers, fabulous people, and parallel to this I founded my own practice and I'm still heading it. At the research institute, where we have the most noble job to really go in the terra incognita, to research what could be possible, always taking the risk to fail and to get a bloody nose, but we take that risk. Because this is the job of a university, not applied research. We go beyond the known, the line of what is the line of the already known into the area of the unknown. How do we do that? This headline, built for more people with less material, necessitates, as I already said, full recyclability, no waste, zero waste. My friend Michael Braungart is probably here. He calls that cradle to cradle for more people. And it necessitates lightweight technologies. So lightweight technologies can be, let's say, categorized into three groups. The one is use materials which are highly efficient. Okay. The second group is invent or design structures which are highly efficient. And the third group is use systems where one element has several functions, still having least weight. We are very strong in the two last groups. We go very far with this. We build with air. Every one of you knows air-inflated domes, air-inflated halls. We build also air-inflated cushions, air-inflated pipes. We use air, pressurized air, as a building material. But not only in the overpressurized way, we also developed the so-called vacuum facade, and we designed the first vacuum facade ever built, which is an outdoor as well as indoor skin of a huge hall, which is held in place by negative pressure. So imagine you have a huge steel structure spanning over 40 by 50 meter clear span, and you need to cover that. So we sew a huge piece of fabric, several thousand square meters big. We threw it over the steel structures, we pulled it below, we shortcutted it so that we had a big closed bag, and then we evacuated the bag. And if you enter the building, you see a sheer white wall and roofing, and that's all held in place by negative pressure. So we built with no air. And interesting thing is we do that to push the border lines forwards. And at the same time, we study this recyclability thing, because if you switch off the pressure pump, which is smaller than a football, and which needs an energy less than 10 square meters of photovoltaic, if you switch off the pressure pump, then the light fabric just sails down slowly, you roll it up, and you reuse or recycle it in a very self-understanding way. And it's always important that the buildings we are doing are so unbelievable beautiful that the people like to touch them, that they like to identify themselves with them. It is not this what we call in German Entsagungsästhetik, yeah? So breathe, flow, do not do any sports because you are a member of a society which is the worst one ever. No, just have fun and fall in love with the building, because if the people love the buildings, then they take care of them. So this is a part of an insight of what we are doing. It is from building physics to energy consumption. It sounds sometimes very technical, but the technology we had to develop is nothing else than the keyboard we need to play a melody.
Gloria Solano, maybe you could start just by sharing, talking about getting a bleeding nose and taking risk, how risky it was to build the brick vault over there, how close it was not to even happen. And from that difficulty, explain how it's not just a difficulty for an exhibition. Maybe that's a condition you every single day have to face while building in Paraguay, which is the majority of the world. So, but maybe start with some insights and very concrete your experience while trying to put up that brick vault here.
15 days before, sorry for my really bad English first. 15 days before the inauguration, the Biennale inauguration, we don't have nothing in the exposition. We start with prepare the formwork, and we start to prepare the first bars for make the triangles and for make all the structure. And 2 days after this, the constructor here, the Italian constructor, say it's not possible. This is impossible. We cannot make, and short time. It's really short time. And no, this. And we talk with Alejandro and. We say, okay, plan A is we have all the structure. Plan C is have the formwork and start with sand, brick. And I say, no, we really won't have all plan A. And we start with the BART. We tried with another mortar, with another concrete, and in 5 days we made all the structure, and we finished. In 1 day we made all the formwork, and 4 days for put all the bricks and the concrete, and 4 days. After this, we take the form, and the day with the inauguration, we take the form and open the doors. but for us, it's normal, because always when we try make some new structure, some new form, the construction, all the time we have the problem in the first time. The people say, no, this is impossible. And we need this time for break the manera de pensar,
mind structure.
Mind structure. And when in one moment, when the people say, okay, we can make this, this is the moment for the victory. And after this, we only see the worker take selfie like the structure all the time. And the same guy say, no, this is impossible. 5 days ago, take picture. And everybody feel like your work. Su trabajo.
Sound work. Thank you very much for your kind invitation again for the Biennale. We have some reputation to do what we don't know how to do. That's what we try to do here too. It's very common to link our practices with other practices made by Briggs. For example, Eladio Dieste is an amazing engineer from Uruguay, makes some beautiful structures using the Briggs and Armet bricks to expand spaces in an amazing way. But we really hate that engineer. We really hate the bricks too, because for many reasons. First of all, we don't have the capacity of calculation, have the engineers. For that, it's a very first important limitation for us. Second, for example, for the practice of Eladio Dieste, he fabricates his own bricks and know exactly the capacity of every single brick. And we normally in Paraguay, we work with common bricks, and nobody knows the capacity of the bricks. And that's why we can do what Eladio Dieste do, or we can do what the amazing structure here, for example, in Italy or here in Venice, to build with this expanded historically capacity. But the gap where we can offer an opportunity is the way, how can you do that? How can you build that? Because in many universities around the world, now the engineers and the researchers develop incredible machines, have the capacity of do amazing bricks structure or with other materials. But in every single part of the world, for example, a very important country, the most important country of the world, Paraguay, our country, of course, we have a lot capacity in this way to think. We found a machine with the capacity to do supination, pronation, rotation, and translation and rotation. And we waste this capacity because we think that is not important. It's very important to be efficient. The efficiency is the goal of this moment. But we refuse that, and we think we can be with efficacy. It's a difference proposed, because efficiency measure one single task, only how can you use less material, the highest or the highest expanse, or the velocity or the less quantity of money to use for the construction. But that's not have sense when you have time, people, resources, other demands, and you can use everything around you to support a better life for our societies. Understanding that, we start to produce, to design how can we use the labor, the hand
mano de obra,
the workforces of our country to do what we don't imagine. And using that, we try to expand the limit of our current discipline to give opportunity to us, our society. Bricks is not a very good material. You can take a brick here and you can say, brick, wait here, and you fall and the bricks fall because it's stupid. But it's the capacity of the human beings to transform the material in a monument. You can take every single matter and you can demand the matter. How can you contribute to build a better society, the refugio, how can I say refugio? The shelter for the human capacity, and how can we give response to our society, losing the how can I say that? Esperar, the don't wait the develop of the scientists, the local scientists, to have a big architecture. Start to think how can, knowing what we know and having what we have, how can imagine new opportunities for a better life for everyone. That's way normal. I am the English teacher of Gloria. Sorry.
Well, I guess that even though from our side as curators we never said it, there was a kind of expectation that this would be the kind of humanitarian biennale or the biennale of the poor or something. And for us was very important that if the question is difficult, what you need is professional quality, not professional charity. Every single bit of wisdom and knowledge is necessary to tackle issues. So that's why the experience of Solano in a context with very limited resources, it's crucial, but the work of cutting-edge engineering, like what Werner is doing, too. And I would say that's the case also of Oxendorf, Bloch, and De Jong. When we met for the first time, I was completely amazed by your research in using only gravity as a way to put matter together, not as a goal in itself, but again, as another way to save materials. I remember you telling the first time making this research in allowing structures not to bend, hence the name of your exhibition, Beyond Bending. I put the title, The War on Bending, on your exhibition, that if you avoid bending, you can save up to 70% of the matter used in a structure, 70. And this has huge consequences on labor, money, resources, etc. So, and you're doing this not as a kind of nostalgic thing, but going to the past to find that knowledge with cutting edge technology. And this is the kind of thing that we need. So if you can share what you've been researching, what are you looking for? To start with, you're all engineers. You're not architects. So please develop.
I am also an architect, but yes, we are mainly engineers. And also, thank you very much, not only for the invitation here, but also to be able to explain in our words what we're doing. So exactly, that was a trigger, right? That we were talking about this floor that I was designing in Zurich, where we go away from the simple plate, the floor plate, where we always assume that if you have to span space in Switzerland, in Germany, anywhere in Europe, you use a floor plate. But what you're doing is you're adding a certain depth because you want to take bending. You want to have compression and tension sufficiently apart from each other. And then on top of that, to protect the reinforcements, you add 3.5 centimeters of dead weight just in order for the system to work. So what we actually did is, one of the key things that we do, as you already mentioned, is to learn from the past and to bring things back that have been forgotten or where we actually don't know anymore how to do these things. And so one of the important ideas is to replace a plate or a beam that is straight by an arch and a tension tie. So basically by replacing it by a very simple system. So that is what we show. If you have seen our exhibition, you see these four models of floor systems. The first one is actually a very traditional tile vaulted system. It's called Catalan vaulting or Guastavino vaulting. And it's a technique that actually was able to be built in space with a minimal amount of formwork. So you can basically, with a faceting mortar, build these spaces. So that was actually the trigger for the very first project that we did to extend this knowledge that we don't use too much. And so the next floor that you see is actually an earthen floor. That was a project that we've done in South Africa and then another one in Ethiopia, where we basically can just compress the tiles. So this is just local soil. With, dependent on the soil, you add a little bit of cement. And we're talking about only 6 to 7% of cement. But the floor that you see in the exhibition has no cement whatsoever. So the result is that you're using a material that is extremely weak, that can just take a little bit in compression, but if you hold one of these tiles on one end, then they just break in bending. So that maybe sounds very scary, but what's the key there is that if you follow where the forces want to go in compression, the stresses are very low, and you can use these weak materials very safely. And so that was actually one of our challenges, also to show how you can use these materials safely. So what we show in the exhibition, you see that there is these rips, these stiffeners. And that is because an arch is not stable by itself. If you have an earthquake, it will collapse. If you have a point load, it will collapse. So you need a system to make it safe for other loading cases, and that's why we add these stiffeners. And I'll come back to the project that we have done with Lord Foster outside. There we use another technique to stiffen for live loads. So that was a starting point for us, but then suddenly we made the click that actually why should we use these old techniques only to do better in developing countries? So we do projects in Africa, we do projects in other countries where you have a lot of labor, but you don't have cement, you don't have steel and things like that. So then suddenly we use the same context, the same concepts also, but we translated it into modern materials. And we wanted to do something that is meaningful for where we live here. So how can we use these same ideas? And that's where this floor system, this concrete floor system came about. So what we actually do is instead of having to protect the reinforcements internally because you need it for bending, we externalize the tension ties. So on the inside, we can just be in compression, like the historic masonry structures. So that means that, and this is a real project, it will be built starting early 2017 in Zurich. We are talking about a 4 by 4 meter floor with only 2 centimeters of unreinforced concrete. And so this is also something that I enjoy, that hopefully, if you're builders, then you say like, no, that's not possible, that's silly, that is a dumb idea, because concrete needs to be reinforced. Well, again, not when you follow where the forces want to go. And again, you see all these stiffeners, that is how we take the live loads to the corners. So that for us was an important shift to not literally translate, not use the same techniques, but to make them appropriate for a context like Switzerland. Why is it appropriate in Switzerland? In Switzerland, labor is ridiculously expensive. So you want to go to a very controlled prefab unit where you can everything do in the factory, bring it on site, minimal labor. In an African context, what is appropriate there? It's not about an efficient structural unit. It's about capitalizing on the labor that you have there, but do it with a minimal amount of imported materials. So that is appropriate there. And then the last model that we showed is the future. Is that perhaps you've heard of the revolution of digital fabrication, where you don't need to build a very expensive mold to make your concrete floor, but you can basically 3D print freely and adapt to any geometry. And so the last floor is again structural. It's a material that is not expected to be structural because it's as weak as the soil tiles that we use in Africa, but we can really employ that because we use these new technologies. Anyway, so that was the obvious reason we were invited. But then I thought, okay, we are invited as engineers. Engineering is not just about optimization. Engineering can also be damn sexy. And that is why we also decided to do something absolutely crazy, which is perhaps you have bumped into it or you have fallen over the tension ties of the big stone vault that we've done. Why did we do this? Basically, John, you were telling me earlier, Alejandro, that John Oxendorf, my partner, my former advisor at MIT, he's quite right when he says that 6 months ago, no one would be able to design, engineer, or build such a thing. And there's different aspects there. The key thing is actually that we resort back to techniques that again have been forgotten. In engineering, that is one of our battles. In engineering, there is one way to look at structures, and that is using finite element analysis, for those of you who know these kind of things. And you forget how to discover good form. And so the same ideas, the same concepts, the same methods that we use to optimize our floors, we actually can also design these extremely expressive structures. So then we went almost a little bit perverse and overboard, because why did we do a cut stone crazy vault? And the important point there is that it is about good structural form. So this can be built in any material. If you build this in concrete, it can be even thinner. If you build this in bamboo, it's also a good structural form, and so on. But what we wanted to do is we wanted to demonstrate, we wanted to use non-traditional techniques that nowadays are not allowed in practice, are not ready yet because we have forgotten them. We do the same as what the master builders did, but we extended by computation, and we took this opportunity to go all the way and to demonstrate that you can find a combination between expression and efficiency. Why am I talking about efficiency? Because this structure is the most dramatic kind of demonstration of something that is nicely in balance. What you're looking at is 399 stones cut, no mortar, no glue, nothing holding it together than equilibrium. So perhaps you might return a little bit more nervous next time when you stand there. So this for us was actually a nice challenge, and was for us the important, hopefully something that makes you stop, makes you realize that perhaps there is something to this story that we want to know more about. Actually, some numbers about the vault. I am half an engineer, or a confused engineer after all. You have spans of 16 meters with only 5 centimeters touching in the middle. If you translate this to an eggshell, that means that our structure is half to a third of the thickness of an eggshell. So this, again, without glue and so on. So we wanted really to push engineering through such a dramatic kind of stone structure. Sharing a little bit the behind, obviously, this is not something when I say you could not do this 6 months ago. This is true, but this is based on so many years of research, and more importantly, so many years also of very close collaboration between the designers, the engineers, and the constructors. Because in fact, 8 years ago, I did my internship at the Escobedos, who built this extreme structure. And so we have been developing these ideas to get there. So just from a stone technology kind of point, which is not a higher level message, but this is a modern day cathedral after so many years. But to me, what I wanted to achieve is, can we find a mix between Zaadit and the master builder? And so can we show that efficiency doesn't need to be its own box, that we don't have to either do good or do crazy, exciting architecture, but that all of this, that we can narrow the gap, that we basically can do things better, more efficiently, and so on. Quickly coming back to the floor, by the way, because you say 70%, the 70% is only calculated on the floor unit itself. When you were to stack this in a high rise and you start to calculate the savings on the primary structure, on the foundations and so on, you can imagine what the humongous, that's actually not a word, but the huge impact would be on saving materials. And so that is something that we thought was worth to share and that we really wanted to share in this context. And then just quickly connecting it to the project with Lord Foster outside, is that this is actually a continuation of our work in an African context for the drone port for Rwanda. And there we don't use stiffeners, but we use good double curvature to make this into a very safe and stable structure. So we, the challenge there, because we have gotten, well, online there is all kind of comments, but so many students built these style vaults because it's easy. Just to give a bit of background, what was the big challenge there is that it's a prototype to be built all over Africa. So we optimized the geometry to be as equally stressed as possible, and we optimized the formwork so that you can send an extremely lightweight and safe kit of parts so that people locally can build this with the knowledge that is embedded in the system, in the package. And for us, this is extremely exciting as an opportunity, because if you start to build these drone ports all over Africa, starting in Rwanda, then you can have these seeds of learning a new, in my opinion, more appropriate technology to build spans and so on. I hope I didn't go over time. Yeah.
But you wanted to comment on that. Okay. Well, Simone, working in bamboo, and you mentioned about this is not possible anymore, about it's not accepted, and even within the codes. And I guess one of the battles, when we first started communicating for how to come and what to bring, I asked, what's your battle? You were describing how difficult it is to advocate for a use of a material that, if you rank the good sides, it's obviously something desirable, and yet the building code does not allow it to be used, particularly in public buildings. And giving there's no industry behind, nobody's lobbying for changing the codes for which we have now the technology to make it otherwise. So you were saying that besides the knowledge and the structure in each of the projects, it was a kind of test to prove with facts that we may reconsider things. And this it happens with bamboo, and a Heringer, the same thing with mud. So how to take use of the vegetal steel, how you call it, for things that make sense? The carbon footprint is nice, but yet we do not have the right building code environment that allows that to happen. So if you can develop.
Well, in the year 2000, I was awarded in the Netherlands by the royal family for a cultural award. So that gave me a lot of prestige in Colombia. And at that precise moment, the government had hired a group of engineers to write the new building code of Colombia according to the earthquakes. We have really strong, very strong earthquakes. And it's our biggest concern on building in Colombia are the earthquakes. So the engineers hired by the government to do the new building code, they have already written that it's not allowed to build out of bamboo in the new building code. So when I came back from the Netherlands, the president itself called me for congratulations, and I told Mr. President, your government is going to ban the use of bamboo. He couldn't believe, because he is kind of a peasant like I am. So he called the minister in charge of that, and the minister said, Mr. President, I don't know, but let me call somebody. So that guy appeared and said, yes, Mr. Minister, Mr. President, it's already written the law not to allow the use of bamboo because of earthquake reasons. So the president said, stop that, and they hired me to build the new building code for bamboo. But I am not an engineer. So I hired a real engineer, and he wrote 80 pages of a building code for bamboo. And I think Colombia was the very first country to get a building code for bamboo. But they wanted to ban it, and they were the engineers that only think in concrete. We are a poor country, a banana republic like Paraguay also, but maybe we are more criminals. We are very proud of that. So the use of bamboo is a traditional way of building where I was born. But they used to build a lot, too much, with bamboo. And then came, like 80 years ago, a very big fire and destroyed the whole city where I was born. And it was rebuilt with concrete imported from Denmark and USA. And nobody else wanted to build with bamboo anymore. And I agree, because you better die in an earthquake and not in a big fire. So when you abuse of the use of wood, the fire becomes even much more dangerous than the earthquakes. So I am always obsessed telling the people, I am kind of a vernacular architect, so from the vernacular tradition, start again a building tradition that mix materials. Use bamboo, use wood, use concrete, use steel, and mix all them together to make non-rigid structures, light structures, and flexible structures. But you don't get that only using bamboo, or you don't get that only using steel, or only using concrete. We have to be like the cookers. You cook with many different materials. If you only cook with rice, you become like a Chinese or Japanese. With even them, they have a rich tradition of cooking. And the culture is rich in the amount of diversity that you do. I come from a very diversity country. We have huge biodiversity. And as an architect belonging to that kind of jungle country, you have to express that biodiversity using a lot of diversity materials. And one of them is bamboo. I became kind of famous because bamboo, but I am not a bamboo architect. I also work with bamboo. And I always say, architecture has to be a little bit more vegetarian. We are too much minerals, too much concrete, too much steel, too much glass, too much brick. We have to mix with vegetables, but we have to eat meat also. Okay. Okay.
We met in the airport yesterday by chance and coming here and then now at lunch. And whenever you have had the opportunity, you talk about bamboo with such a depth, with such a knowledge. You know about this thing so much. And can you share a bit about this material that you've paid so much attention to?
Well, I'm very proud because I had never get a building license in Colombia. When a country is so corrupted, you have to do corruption to the corrupted guy. So I never get a building permit there. It's against my religion. But I always hire an engineer because it is the engineer who has to go to jail, not the architect. Because when you build, you can kill a lot of people. So you need responsabilidad. You cannot build in such a hippie folkloric way. So since always when a structure starts to be a little bit big, I always hire an engineer. And there are two engineers, close friends of mine, that they already know the use of the material, and one of them did a master in Chile, that they have a very high specialized university trained by the Germans forestal engineers in Biobío or something like that. So I used one of those engineers, but now he's very much focused on bamboo. And I really want to build big structures, but not only bamboo, steel, concrete, wood, I mix materials. But the most charismatic material of all of those is the bamboo. But I love concrete, I love steel, and I really like those high-tech materials like Mr. Werner used, but we come from a very poor country. But we are not as poor as many other countries in the world. We have the both countries. We have the very opulent richness, but also the very, very poor people. But again, engineering is really an important matter. I really always hire engineers, and I try to think as an engineer, but I am not.
Thank you.
We spent yesterday evening together and half the day, and I really admire what he's doing. And we, maybe just as an information for you, the strength of bamboo is, let's say, composed out of two effects. The one is a very clever structural system, that bamboo is just a hollow pipe. And the second is a material quality, because bamboo has vertical reinforcing fibers, the strength of which is, you don't need to know the nomination, 30,000 compared to regular steel, which is 500. So it's 60 times stronger than steel. and much, much lighter. So nowadays, researchers try to somehow get those fibers out of a bamboo and weave them to a fabric, which is then, of course, of high load-bearing capacity. I just wanted to put that in because it's a result of actual research in Germany and very interesting. I hope that not too many engineers of yours are in jail already.
Oh, we have a nice long conversation last night, and I have a trouble because I think my first time in my life I drink water, and I almost died last night. I should have kept drinking wine or beer.
Philip touched with his very, very important and interesting work a very, let's say, important point. I think most of you will be architects, but for the non-architects amongst you, if you open the standard books on how to design a building and you look at the so-called building elements, then they're all geometrically predetermined. We talk about a column, we talk about a beam, we talk about a shear wall, or in German, eine Wand, we talk about a plate. At the very, very end, at page 180 to page 185, people are talking about shells and nets and all those complicated things. But the main issue is geometrically predetermined element, which can be used as a given to design a house, like this. And this works since thousands of years. But if you look at each of those elements under a structural engineering or material efficiency standpoint, they do not really make sense. Because most of the materials built into a beam or a plate is dramatically underloaded. So if we all agree to the necessity that we have to build with less material for more people, it means that we have to build light, you run into a real problem. You cannot design any longer in thinking in geometries, which is somehow easy to understand and comprehend. You have to design in forces, which even most of the engineers are unable to do, because you have to think in three-dimensional force fields, then pick up the most efficient ones, and then materialize them. And the outcome is things like a shell. But a shell, as logic as it looks, or your works in bamboo with a curved bamboo, as logic as it looks, most people wouldn't be even unable to describe the geometry precisely. When it comes to double curved, 3D curved things, we, being human beings, have difficulties to fully understand the geometry. And to fully understand the flow of forces inside is even more complicated. This is a certain limitation. And then you can approach that on two paths. The one is make experiments, tiny build things, and look at them and touch them and squeeze them in order to get a feeling for it. Or you work with highly elaborated computer methods, which at the end drop the right result, but do not really raise your comprehensiveness, because it's still a certain abstractness on a 2D screen. So this transition from a more architecturally driven, geometrically predetermined element combination of to a relatively complicated designing of force fields in a 3D environment, this is where we have somehow, and we did not yet, where we have somehow to find our tools and methods to do that, because this is the key to use less material. And as important all these shells and things are, nobody really wants to sleep on them or to walk on them, because human beings, stupid as they are, they prefer the plain surface. And sometimes it makes very much sense to have a vertical plane surface. So obviously the realm for optimization is zero then. So we said, okay, if this is the case, and we have to admit that in many cases it is the case, that it makes sense that the plate is flat, if you cannot bend it, what can we do then in order to save 50, 60, 70% of material? Then we came up with the idea of optimizing the interior of a building element. Not to design the exterior shape, but to design the interior by building in cavities, hollow spheres, or whatever it might be, in a very irregular way, and placing always these non-material cavities where there is no stress within the building element. And doing so, you might imagine, in the morning, maybe next morning, when you have breakfast, just cut a piece of bread and then look inside the piece of bread and its structure. And it's something spongy, like a foam. And if you then scale this up and imagine this is concrete now, then you see what we are actually researching and working on, coming up with a weight saving of 70% for one and the same piece of the same capacity, than a massive one. And this is a second very important step, not only optimizing the exterior, but also the interior. Imagination-wise, it is even more complicated. But comprehending the geometric structure of a piece of bread is something which brings most human beings at the limits, at least mine. But this is a view into the future.
Sorry, Alejandro, I quickly wanted to pick up because I wanted to continue with the engineer kind of not only the going to jail part and so on, but it's also that all the opportunity and the kind of enthusiasm that we can use weak materials, local materials and so on, also that has also a flip side. It also has a bit of a, and you're pointing it exactly, that once you go to materials that actually are only happy in compression, for example, then you do need to go to another level of expertise, either in the material but also in the engineering. And so you want to team up with an engineer, but the problem is, and that is what Professor Zobek was just saying, is that the codes, the norms, the methods are absolutely not there to help the meaningful projects. So they are not... You don't know what to do with an arch. I mean, I was entirely frustrated when I went to MIT and John Oxendorf showed me where the forces wanted to go. I was supposed to already be an engineer in Belgium, and I had no idea about what he was teaching all these architects. So it's just that these tools have been forgotten, they have been lost, and I think that is really an issue, because, to repeat, it can quickly become dangerous if you don't have someone that can give you that support and that thinks outside, literally outside of the square and rectilinear box, that really goes and understands these kind of new types of forms that are necessary for these materials. I just wanted to go.
I guess you've both from different sides arrived to something that I think it's very, very crucial in architectural discussion nowadays. We're living in a time, and then if you look at the media commenting about the Biennale, there is a kind of general joy that finally architects will be going out of spectacle of forms that are there just to shock and will come to something that makes sense. And I guess the importance of this particular gathering, other venues will have different subjects, is that in structure, in forces, there seem to be finally some objectiveness, that arbitrariness of form making has to calm down because you can't discuss on facts, on things that you can prove, that you can give security margins. So some of the arbitrariness of the thing can be taken out, and then the discussion can become with more sense, let's say. But all of you have mentioned beauty. Structurally speaking, to have flat things doesn't make any sense, but then we happen to atavically, primitively, be connected to this kind of world. So, just a lateral comment. I remember John and you saying, in order to calculate the structure there, and this is the kind of things that affects form, the loading on each piece of the floor of the corderie couldn't be more X amount. So the amount of stone blocks that were there were put in place with your internal restriction that it shouldn't be more than people gathering at the same place. So let's say if you look at that structure and if you have people close to each other, that weighs more than that structure over there. So the form follows some flows that is less than people standing on that. I remember when developing the vault, we got into the same problem. How much this thing weighed originally was a double structure, and it could stand in itself, but then the amount of load on the ground was too high. So you were planning to have the arch putting the weight on the wall. You went back to adjust the height, the structure, and you, Gloria, particularly, were sending back and forth the calculations online. I mean, in your sketchbook, you were calculating the weight of the structure until you arrived to that final form. Solano in Paraguay, you here. It was a very objective discussion, and yet there's a degree of freedom that cannot be explained by calculations. Can you very quickly elaborate about these other dimensions that ultimately explain decisions? We're trying to go away from arbitrariness, but yet some unspeakable thing is in there. What is that?
I try to explain when I say the brick is very stupid, because it's very interesting try to share this kind of knowledge, because it's the common link with the people. I can start to speak like an artist about the importance of the beauty, the extreme skinny of one structure, how elegant or how the measure of the distance, etc. But only to enjoy the beauty and to feed your soul. But at the same time, okay, that's it's present there. Everything you can arrive to that place and you can feel something, because it's very interesting, the dimension, the material, etc., etc. It's a challenge what you transport for the common material and for the common life of the people. But it's interesting to do how can you do that. It's just interesting to share with the people. And when we do to learn and learn doing. And that's the command for us to understand many things, because we don't have amazing laboratories in our country. We don't have the help of the capacity of the scientists, mathematical, etc. We do to learn and learn doing. And that is important to us to understand what are we doing there. For example, we only use 1,872 bricks for do that. And that's a very important date for us, because it's the exactly quantity of weight to support the ground of the Giardini space. And if you understand, if you have 1,872 bricks, if you use normally like a normal wall, you can use 60 bricks per each square meter. For that, you have more or less 30 square meters of a normal, a common wall. And if you have a room with 2 meters and 40 centimeters, the quantity of bricks, you can make some room of 3.25 meters by 3.25 meters for 2 meters and 0.4 meter high. That's all what we do there. And the space inside of these bricks have more or less 25 cubic meters. And the space under the not above, because it's not above, it's a ceramic bar structure curve. It's not above, because we think in how can we make bar structures with bricks and persecute the idea of the minimum quantity, we use the curve form. But the central idea of that is a bar structure made by bricks, concrete, and steel. And the cube meter inside of the knot valve have more or less 183 cubic meters. That's the difference between a normal construction with the same material and another imaginary path for the same material and the same labor to do what it's current to do. And that it's an opportunity to cover more efficacious and efficient spaces for all the people. It's not the beauty or the skin, how can skinny, or the good news about this is it's possible for many other people. It's not a challenge of specialism, extremely specialism. Everyone, every single part of the world can use this like an opportunity, like a key to transform his life.
I mean, I could really stay here a long time talking about the most nerdy details about the thing, but I guess that people would get bored and want to continue seeing the exhibition. So as a final remark, Italy has had an earthquake a couple of days ago. Here we're talking about forces. Normally, in terms of forces, we think a lot about gravity, but when the forces come laterally, accelerated in the form of an earthquake, then the entire game changes. So maybe as a final remark, some concept, idea, advice, or whatever for what has just happened.
I think you have to think with flexibility. The structure cannot be that rigid and cannot be so much concrete, so much stone. You have to mix steel, wood, not bamboo because it's from the tropics, but to make a much more flexible structure. Mixing materials, not only concrete, not only brick, not only steel. Steel is very bad for fire. It's better the resistance of wood against the fire than the resistance of the steel against the fire, because the steel can collapse by temperature. The wood doesn't collapse by temperature, only by the direct flame. So my suggestion is use much more wood, but not completely out of wood, because the fire becomes a huge trouble. Bamboo, for some strange reason, has much more resistance against fire than the other woods, because it has a lot of silica. In the outside part, it's covered by a big percentage of silica, which is kind of a natural resistance material to not to get it get fire, but it keeps you time.
Well, maybe to continue on your call about forces and flow of forces and so on, I think it's we talked already about redundancy and being certain that you have a system that it doesn't just work in one way, but that can really take other loading cases and so on. But I want to maybe talk a little bit about also the issue of intent and the issue of actually following what you're supposed to do. Because if you see in many regions, like if there's these very shocking images of an earthquake it was not the one here in Italy, but in Turkey, where you see all the traditional buildings are still standing and the new ones collapsed in the same area. And when you look closer, then you see that the traditional buildings had these braces, had these wooden kind of substructures in their surfaces. And so they basically had a clear load path for all these systems to go. While the new buildings go and count, for example, on the stiffness of the joints, a reinforced concrete frame, so you want to open it up to have big windows and so on. All of this is fine, you can calculate this. But if you're in a context, and I'm not suggesting anything, but if you're in a context where maybe these connection details are not followed and so on, then that becomes quickly dangerous. And so these kind of things are important. The relation also between, there is codes and so on, but there is also implementation, there is also trust, there is responsibility of realizing that when you propose a certain system, and that is something that we are extremely concerned and confronted with, if we propose a new way of doing things, then we should not stop with one demonstrator. Then we should go all the way and educate why the system is like that. It's not just a curve. It works because, and so on and so on. And so I think that is also important, is not only the good intent, but then the proper translation, the working with the people that build it, with the people that translate the ideas and so on. So that was a bit of a digression, but I think that doesn't have anything to do with what happened here in Italy. Here in Italy, these are historic structures that were in a region that they were not designed for that, and so they had to come down. That can also, by the way, happen in Boston and New York, because there is big, it's actually a big seismic region. They just have a longer return period. So if there is a serious earthquake in Boston, exactly the same will happen. So this is a very different topic, that is how to retrofit in a responsible, but also in a respective way, a heritage. We can start to go clad all our historic churches with carbon fiber and so on, but then we're basically no longer respecting the genius of these master builders. So that cannot be the point. And so this is a very important research topic here in Italy. There is a lot of research being done there. So there's two things, but I think we're more talking about design. How can we do this in design? And I think there, education on all levels is crazy important.
Okay. For us, the highest dangerous is the termite, not the earthquake for our vegetal countries. But it's interesting because every single knowledge appear, the common link of between all the human beings is the intelligence. If you use the intelligence of the current people, we can resolve many things. We are imaginary people. We are, how can I say that? Burning earth, we make this transparent. And this was a flower in the middle of the country, and then appear a hair, and then a fabric, and now everything around us is, for the human beings, are a fruit of the imagination. And to develop to have new answer for the people, new response for the people, you need to use not the application of the codes, we need to imagine new ideas and bring in all the new ideas, we can resolve very strong problems, like, for example, the earthquakes, or, for example, how can we stabilize material for the next years, not using fire, not producing carbon emission, etc. Around us, the better news was the... it's not the DNA, it's the genoma. The idea of every single way of life have a code, it have a way to resolve problem, to keep the matter and transform the matter in opportunities for us. I think this is in the knowledge of the life for the next century is the key for new opportunities for us in this time.
And sharing the...
I fully agree. I think it's very good that we had this session under this title, Material and Forces and so on. Because on the one hand side, it is obvious that the building industry means all of us, which stands for 50% of the consumption of material, which stands for 50% of the mass waste production, and 35 or even more percent for the CO2 emission and for the energy consumption, fossil-based energy consumption. has something to do. And if we trace backward, and I include myself because I'm one of the older ones, when Stanley Tigerman in Chicago announced the end of the modern style in 1974, what did we face in our professional world? We faced postmodernism, followed by destructuralism, followed by the blob architecture, some colleagues finding out about a Möbius band, and from then on several families have to live in a Möbius band, which was replaced then by Super Dutch, by the morphism in general, and since it did not take that long to find out that this morphisms does not make any sense, but that in bio you find something in the biosphere which makes sense, so it was about biomorphism, which then fell into the next parametricism, which was all about geometry, all about shape and form and how to place the elements to each other. It was never any discussion about the consumption of resources, the production of waste, and all those things. And therefore we called our pavilion Beyond Form, because we said, now let's interrupt this. Form and shape and color and surface, this is so important, definitely. But let's emphasize all our power and our brains and our cooperation and our common thinking to overcome, or to create a keyboard with solutions, tools and methods to make our buildings lighter and more environmental friendly, but still with the same quality to live in. And codes are the worst thing you can meet in that context, because codes are something for, okay, I quote my academic teacher, yeah? So I never said that it was my academic teacher, Jörg Schley, he said this is for the stupids, because the code draws the borderline. But it also encloses a certain know-how and limits your abilities to do something better, because you fall over the code. So we need more freedom. Everyone needs more freedom, as you said. As Simon said, we have to go beyond the codes if we have the conviction that we really have something which is better, and we have to fight that through. And you are taking the engineers, and Philip and I, we have to sign that by ourselves, so we have to take the risk. Maybe I won't be here next year. But what we need, last sentence is, we need in a positive way further development and innovation. Not innovation as lach pour lach, but innovation as a dramatic necessity to somehow dampen the problems which are coming up at the horizon.
In Paraguay, we have not heard waste. But we many times make the exercise how our structure funciona with terremoto. And maybe the same structure make here. This structure is V dimension, have only two dimensions, but if you make the structure bigger, but with three dimensions, and maybe with the first option, you can have these movements for the flexibility and for, and it's about when you say about the geometry, I remember this, because if you change the la manera de ver el foco, you can encontrar, you can search, find the solution with another geometry. You can find and you can make this.
Well, thank you so much for being here, and thank you for coming. So just keep on enjoying so much knowledge that is out there in the exhibition. Thank you so much.